Welcome to Pennsylvania Newsmakers, and as always, thanks for watching. Well, changes in the way that you do your banking, but first, let's take a look at the economy. Back after these words.
Welcome to the fast-paced and unrehearsed weekly discussion featuring the leaders who help shape your world. Join us as we address the issues that impact you each and every day. This is Pennsylvania Newsmakers, and now, here's your host, Terry Madonna.
All right, we have much to cover on Pennsylvania Newsmakers this week. Let's start with the economy of the state of Pennsylvania. Joining me to talk about that is Gene Barr. He's the president and CEO of the Pennsylvania Chamber of Business and Industry. And Dave Taylor, he's the president and CEO of Pennsylvania Manufacturers Association. Well, between the two of you, you have most of the business community represented at this table.
We do. Is that right? Well, I would say, sir, that's true. Yeah.
All right, let's start with, we get different reports on the health and the status of the economy. Obviously, it looks like it's getting better. There has to be some concerns about inflation, as you know. You two are the experts on this. How would you describe the state of the economy in Pennsylvania, David?
Well, obviously, the economy is awash in all of these stimulus dollars that have been coming from Washington. So demand is up, consumer spending is up. But the manufacturing sector is still trying to rebound. There's been distress with supply chains. Obviously, everybody's heard the story about the lack of sensor chips, and that's derailed auto manufacturing. So, mm-hmm. all of those wrenching kind of problems there's still kinks in the system.
Yeah, I'll tell you, everywhere you see help wanted signs all over the place.
I was saying to somebody, help wanted signs are like dandelions this time of year. They are everywhere,
and it's an indication of
what is really holding back a more full recovery, because the federal government is paying an extra $300 on top of the traditional unemployment compensation, which varies, but 50 to 60%. It's really holding things back. And it's most apparent in the restaurant side, but it's not only restaurants. As Dave mentioned, it's hitting supply chain, where manufacturers can't fill the second shift, can't drive the products out that they need. It's hitting trucking firms, where they can't find truck drivers. So again, another supply chain issue.
Yeah.
It's really holding us back. Our unemployment rate is higher than a lot of other states. The majority of states have now said we're done with the extra 300. In those states, the unemployment rate has dropped.
It's dropped.
And their economies are coming back quicker. Right now, as of last month, there are about 9.3 million jobs available in this country. And we know from a national survey that was done that there are people turning jobs down because they're making more money unemployed than employed. Now, let's be honest, there are some other issues out there. But when we have people turning down jobs, when we have people saying, I'm making more unemployed than employed, and roughly half the people in the survey said, I'm not really looking for a job, mm-hmm. and about a third said, I don't plan on working until 2022. Mm-hmm. That's going to impact our recovery.
Yeah. Do you agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. It's undeniable. And it's also insulting to employers when you have the government acting as, competition to the private sector, paying people not to work to then say, well, employers should, somehow come up with the money to fork over to outbid the government. That's crazy.
And wages are up significantly.
Yeah.
When you look at the number on an annualized basis, wages are up significantly.
One of the problems is getting things, as you point out, supply. You want to have work done, you can't get the equipment to do the work, and if you're buying products, you can't get the products. I mean, it takes weeks and weeks and weeks, given the supply chain, right?
No, that's exactly right. And so we need to get back to, to something like normal to allow...
Whatever that means.
Well, I mean, what it means is, allowing the private sector to do what we do, which is to innovate and to solve problems and to find a way forward. But when you have this massive interference from government, wild distortions in the labor market, it's a sensible choice for state governments to decouple from the feds, to go back to the traditional state unemployment compensation, to allow people to have the real world re-enter the economy.
And look,
go ahead.
Neither one of us is saying, each of us would agree, that we need a safety net. You need that unemployment compensation
Absolutely,
safety
yes.
net, no question about it. But when you begin to layer that on top and people say, well, it was 600 last year, it was, but keep in mind, so many businesses were closed, we did not see the full impact. In many cases, you did, and I can point to places where that happened. Now that we're reopening, this 300 is absolutely acting as a hindrance to our full recovery. You're seeing it, as we say, in supply chains, in trucking companies, in manufacturing, across the board. You're seeing it in construction, which is probably coming into the home construction.
We're going to hold your thought. We're going to run to a break when we come back. We also want to throw in the aspects of the state budget that relate.
Sure.
We'll do that after these words.
This broadcast of Pennsylvania Newsmakers is presented by the Pennsylvania Chamber of Business and Industry, the statewide voice of business, and by the Pennsylvania State Education Association and Partners for Public Education, bringing the power of a great education to our schools, our students, and our communities. This broadcast of Pennsylvania Newsmakers is brought to you by the Pennsylvania Highway Information Association, the go-to source to learn about transportation projects and issues. Please visit pahighwayinfo.org. And by the Pennsylvania Manufacturers Association. Business in Pennsylvania is our business.
Welcome back. Well, I'm chatting with Gene Barr and Dave Taylor. We're talking about aspects of the economy, and one aspect of it, Gene Barr, has to do with the state budget. What's the relationship between, do I got this right, $40 billion?
Yeah, it was a pretty big increase, and some of that's related to the fact that over the last few years they took certain things offline. Reality is still a pretty big spend, as has been the case for years and years. I've been in Harrisburg for 29. It's a historic spend in education again, which went up not as much as some would like and maybe a little more than others would like. We would like to see more outcomes based on that. But there was significant spend. One of the positives was we got rid of the overtime rule that was going to have a tremendous adverse impact on not just businesses. The overtime rule about when you would have to pay somebody overtime, the threshold number when you go from salary to hourly. That's probably the best way of explaining it. Not just business, but schools, nonprofits. One nonprofit we're working with would have been $1 million hit to them.
And that was required before.
There was always a threshold, but the governor proposed a significant upgrade to it, significant increase.
Right.
Again, would have had an adverse impact for businesses coming out of this and also nonprofits. So that was out. Unfortunately, there was some discussions around our corporate net income tax, but which is the second highest rate in the United States, but no progress made there.
Mm-hmm. Well, the...
Oh, I'm sorry. You wanted to say something before
that's
the break.
All right. Water over the dam. But I would say regarding the state budget, I mean, maybe this is the best outcome that that was possible with the current correlation of forces, but $40 billion is a terrifying number. And while they socked away some money for next year's budget and maybe the one after, this is an unsustainable trajectory, especially when you consider that our unemployment compensation fund is depleted, that we are facing huge unfunded liabilities on public pensions. Like, we are in trouble, and that we need serious leadership to address these things while we're still able to.
And our UC fund is worse than depleted. We're roughly $2 billion in the hole borrowed to the federal government. And that's just going to continue, we believe, to get worse. And, again, one of the things that doesn't get talked about is the fact that we lost another congressional seat. And everybody wants to focus on the politics of that. But we lost another congressional seat because we're not a competitive state. We're not attracting investment. We're not growing jobs. We're not keeping population here. That's it.
Gene's exactly right. And Pennsylvania's chronic economic underperformance is the result of the competitiveness differential resulting from state public policy. And the first thing that Harrisburg needs to do is to not spend money faster than people can earn it. Harrisburg's been doing that year over year, decade after decade. And this is why, we are only growing at a fraction of the national average. And this is why we continue to lose population relative to the rest of the country, because people go where the opportunities are. The world does not have to be this way, but we need the will and the vision to fix it.
But here's a question. We have, and I'm using this descriptively, a conservative legislature and a liberal government. And I'm just using that as descriptive.
Absolutely. You're right.
And they agreed handily with this. It wasn't even a debate about the
No, I know.
About
and
the
look, there was
specifics.
A whole lot of money here. There was roughly $3.5 billion that they raised more than anticipated during the recently completed budget year. Unfortunately, a lot of that was spent during the year on these supplemental spends that we all hear about. In addition to that, there was more than $7 billion in federal money. Some of that was put away. So there was huge spends. Mm-hmm. They all wanted to get through this. They wanted to end this. And unfortunately, while there's a lot of folks in the legislature who agree that we have to do better, how they get there, there's still a point of contention, mm-hmm. and of course they don't have a veto override majority, so right. they've got to figure this out. And some of this comes down to the people in Pennsylvania understanding what's at stake here. Mm-hmm. If you're tired of getting on a plane and going to see your kids in Raleigh or Austin or Tampa, then you need to let your elected officials know Pennsylvania needs to do better, because that's where the jobs are
going. Yeah, I mean, and the most challenging thing politically is to hold the line when times are flush. When you've got that much cash on hand, it is very difficult to restrain yourself. And yet, it's in the times when you have the cash on hand that you have, that it's most important to be disciplined so that the baseline doesn't keep moving up. It could have been much worse. I mean, the House Democrats had a plan that was like a five-year-old's letter to Santa. So, I mean, at least we didn't do that. But again, we are in very serious trouble over the horizon, and we're only a few clicks behind Illinois in terms of solvency.
Yeah. Well, look, I want to thank both of you for coming in and providing, the point of view of the business community. All right, changes in the way in which you do banking. We'll get to that after these words.
This broadcast of Pennsylvania Newsmakers is brought to you by Cross-State Credit Union Association. Credit unions, where people are worth more than money. To find a credit union that is right for you, go to ibelong.org. And by the Energy Association of Pennsylvania, Pennsylvania's energy information source. This broadcast of Pennsylvania Newsmakers is brought to you by the Association of Pennsylvania State College and University Faculties, representing the faculty and coaches who are devoted to providing quality public higher education for Pennsylvania's college students.
Well, there are a lot of changes in the way in which we do our banking. Joining me to chat about them is Mike Wishnow. He's a senior VP at Cross State Credit Union Association, and Pam Mon, who is the CEO of the York Educational Federal Credit Union. They're long titles, aren't they? Yeah. Well, look, let's get right to it. There isn't any doubt that mobile banking is taking over the way in which we do our financial business, correct?
That is correct. We're finding more people, especially through this pandemic, your life stopped a little bit. You got out of your routine. You wanted to do things that you couldn't do anymore. So we encourage a lot of our members to do the mobile app, because you can do everything on there. You can deposit your money. You can transfer between your accounts. You can pay your bills. So it was a transition from being in a brick and mortar, and now you're on your phone or your tablet. So it was a definite increase in using your mobility.
Yeah. I'll tell you something. Related to that is using your smartphone. Now, I don't do it, but my wife does. And all of a sudden, we're doing these transactions. Regardless of what they are, it seems like you can use a smartphone for almost everything.
Absolutely. Right? And that's consumer demand, right? So as consumers are more comfortable with the technology, financial institutions like credit unions have to deliver. Mm-hmm. That consumers feel even more comfortable. What's interesting is the counter trend, as we've now sort of begun to come out of this pandemic, is that branch traffic is starting to rise as well. So it's not just the mobile banking. Everything seems to be increasing, and customers are requiring more and more in the way of service. And so financial institutions have to respond.
And the same with debit cards are now being, related to, connected to mobile banking, correct?
Yes, debit cards. We encouraged a lot of our members to use debit cards, and that happened to be more of our mature membership. They're retired. They're used to coming in, seeing you, talking, and then that got cut off. So we had to encourage them to use their debit cards for now. You use them at the grocery store to get money and cash back. They had to change a little bit, but we told them, look, it's just temporary. You can put it away, and then if something like this happens again, at least now you have that resource and you didn't get caught off guard. Like, how am I going to, pay my bills, or how am I going to get a check? How am I going to get my cash? So we encourage them, get the debit card now, use it, and then put it away, And then when the next thing comes around, you know you've got it.
Yeah, good point.
Yeah, and you know, Pam talked about the mature end of the spectrum. The opposite end of the spectrum, the young folks, are actually ditching the credit card, the debit card, and putting it on their phone.
That's all. Well, they live
just
with
using
the phone.
Yeah, just using Apple Pay or a payment program at point of sale, which is also interesting.
Yeah. And by the way, all of us, we all use this now. I mean, how did we survive without it? You got to wonder. All right, let's go. Let's go to the impact of COVID-19. And even though that it looks like COVID-19, it's obviously in decline with the large number of Americans and Pennsylvanians who've been vaccinated, the fact of the matter is that there were restrictions that are now being lifted. So what does that all mean?
Well, sure. I mean, I think that, you know, credit unions and other financial institutions were first responders. We had to be there to service our members, and we had to service our members in a different way that was able to protect their safety and the safety of our employees, right, Pam?
That's correct. It was a struggle. You had to stay focused on safety and health, number one, first and foremost, in every decision that you had to make. And it benefited both sides, employees and the mm-hmm. membership. And staying focused on that helped us put a plan in place to keep servicing our members. There were credit unions that didn't have a drive-through. What do you do? Well, you figured out a way to get the members, you know, their checks, their money, whatever that looked like. You became very innovative, very creative in how to service your members. And then, you know, you got used to that, and then the restrictions lifted, which was great, but you still wanted that safety and that health issue to stay first and foremost, and you got to make your members happy. They didn't like standing outside in lines, or they didn't like using the drive-through. When are you opening your lobbies? You know, the grocery stores are open. Why can't you? And some of us have small lobbies, not as big as some other places.
Yeah.
So you had to be very creative and innovative on how you had to service your members.
Well, the mask restrictions at the state level is gone, but obviously individual restaurants and bars, stores can still have those restrictions.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And as Pam mentioned, some of those innovations, frankly, are going to remain post-pandemic. Things that make it easier for members to do their banking. The reliance, as we're talking about, on mobile stuff, the trend towards more electronic stuff, all of those things are going to live well beyond the pandemic.
Sure. All right. Coming up next, we're going to take a look at fraud detection as related to the subjects we're talking about. Back in a moment.
This broadcast of Pennsylvania Newsmakers is brought to you by the Pennsylvania Medical Society. Inspired physicians committed to the good health of Pennsylvanians and the advancement of the practice of medicine.
Welcome back. Well, we're talking about all things dealing with your money, I think, and finances. And, you know, given the status right now and how many folks are using mobile phones and a whole variety of ways, Michael, there has to be a concern about fraud.
Oh, clearly. Anytime you introduce a new technology or a new program, some hacker figures out how to get access to your funds. The good news is that as financial institutions and fintechs, the small startups, are becoming more and more prevalent, a lot of the fraud detection is really making significant advances. Personally, I got a call on my cell phone about a week and a half ago saying, we have this transaction. It's in a place that you normally don't go. Did you make it? And if not, call us. I did make it. I happened to be on a road trip. I did make the transaction. It was a piece of art for my wife, so it was a significant expense. And my financial institution, my credit union, picked that up and told me, we're looking out for you. And I'm sure you're doing similar stuff, right?
Yeah, you operate a credit union. So what aspects of fraud do you have to deal with?
A lot. What's really good is, like Mike said, we have things in place that if you make a purchase, we know that it's not you, or it's not a normal place where you would be, or the store that you normally wouldn't go to, and we make that phone call. And I think when we were talking earlier about the mobile app, people are looking at their accounts a lot more than they would have just from a computer or calling in to get a balance. So they're seeing their accounts and they're saying, wait a minute, I didn't order anything from Apple iTunes, and they call us. And then we start our steps there as far as, you know, finding out if we need to close the card down, give you a new card, those kind of things. But yeah, it's come a long way where our members, they get the phone call and they appreciate that. They're like, wow, you guys really have our backs. We appreciate you putting all those things in place for us.
And there are models that have been and are being developed to deal with this so that, you know, not just detection, but prevention.
Correct.
Isn't prevention really what we should be aiming for?
Well, as a financial institution, for sure, because, you know, again, from a consumer, there's limited liability. But from the financial institution's perspective, absolutely. They don't want to be taking on losses from fraud. And really it is. You're right, Terry. It's big data and it's artificial intelligence. And it's the computers figuring out what your normal patterns and practices are. And anything that lands outside that is flagged for the financial institution. At that point, one of your folks takes a look at it and makes a determination. Yeah. Do we need to notify the member or don't we?
Yeah, while we're on fraud detection, you didn't indicate, here's a question. How much of it is going on? I don't know if you can put a percentage to it. If you can't, that's fine. But how common is this?
Fraud is common. I think it just depends on your financial institution and what you have in place and the education to your membership and to your staff. At our credit union, our fraud is very minimal because we're on it. We've got things in place that alerts us, alerts our members, and we educate them. And that's a huge piece, educating your staff to look for things and educating your membership to look for things as well.
When people are looking for a financial institution, it seems to me, based on what you've just said, that fraud detection should be part of your decision in terms of where you end up, you know, what financial institution you end up joining.
Yeah, it's something that most consumers don't think about, quite frankly.
Yeah.
But the good news is that most financial institutions are pretty adept at it. Again, it has to do with the fact that if you use a Visa or a MasterCard, as a consumer, you have zero liability. Really, the cost is to the financial institution. And if you wanted to quantify it, Terry, according to Forbes magazine last year, 2021, the cost of fraud to financial institutions across the country was about $12 billion, with a B, dollars. So again, the consumers don't pay anything.
Yeah.
The financial institutions are the one stuck holding the bag.
Yeah. But again, in summary, big data is essential for detection of fraud, correct?
Yes, that's correct. Big data is a good resource for us to figure out what we need to do moving forward to help prevent this fraud with our members.
And that also is part of the balance between privacy and protecting consumers.
All right, thanks for coming in. All right, we're going to have a couple weeks off for the Olympics, but we'll see you after that, and stay well.